कुमारी नितिका,
गुड मॉर्निंग सर, आई एम ऑडिबल टू यू सर?
यस यू आर ऑडिबल। क्या प्रोफेसर सूर्य कुमार सर ने ज्वाइन किया क्या?
यस सर, प्रोफेसर सूर्य हैज जॉइंड सर।
एंड राजेश सर?
यस सर, ऑल हैव जॉइंड सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग प्रोफेसर सूर्य सर। डॉक्टर राजू सर, गुड मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग प्रोफेसर सूर्य, गुड मॉर्निंग डॉक्टर राजू, होप वी आर ऑडिबल टू यू।
यस गुड मॉर्निंग मैम, यस यू आर ऑडिबल। गुड
मॉर्निंग राजू सर, हाउ सर?
फाइन सर, फाइन सर। गुड मॉर्निंग दलवीर सर।
सर कैन वी स्टार्ट सर?
डेफिनेटली सर, डेफिनेटली सर।
थैंक यू वेरी मच सर।
ओके।
गुड मॉर्निंग लेडीज एंड मैन एंड ऑल आवर स्टीम गेस्ट पार्टिसिपेंट्स एंड लवली पीपल फ्रॉम द वेरियस स्टेट्स ऑफ इंडिया। On behalf of CEDM Maxipa team, I, Colonel Dalveer Singh, feel honored and delighted to welcome you all for 2 days online training program on early warning and communication. It is my privilege to accord a courteous welcome to Professor Surya Prakash, Head Geometeorological Risk Management Division, NIDM, Ministry of Home Affairs, Government of India. His presence in this training program is a reflection of the importance that is attached to this program. Sir, we are grateful to you for being on board for this training program in spite of your busy schedule, sir. And
thank you, Dalveer ji.
Thank you, so nice, sir. Nice to say. We are also delighted to have and honored to have Dr. Raju Thapa, consultant, NIDM, Government of India, Ministry of Affairs, on board for this program. Dr. Raju sir, the most courteous welcome to you. You are very kind to us and for conduct this training programs. On this occasion of this inaugural session, on behalf of the CEDM Maxipa team, I would like to thank the NIDM, Ministry of Home Affairs, for selecting Maxipa as knowledge partner for this very important training. This program enables us to expand our capacity building efforts to address various players involved in disaster management. This program is a joint initiative of NIDM, Ministry of Home Affairs, Government of India, and CEDM Maxipa, Government of Punjab. Once again, I, on behalf of Maxipa team, extend a very hearty welcome to galaxy of eminent officials from NIDM, key speakers, and esteemed participants to this online training program. Sir, I would like to inform you that more than 150 participants have registered for today's program from various states and various departments. And this program is also being live streamed on YouTube. All are requested to keep the video on during the training program and keep your audio on mute to avoid any background this disturbance. With this note, I hand over to Madam Nitika, my colleague, who is the Associate Head of CEDM, Maxipa team, Governor Punjab, for conduct of this inaugural session. Over to Nitika.
Thank you, Colonel Dalveer Singh, for your kind and gentle words. Thank you very much, sir. A very good morning to one and all present here. I, Nitika, on behalf of Mahatma Gandhi State Institute of Public Administration, Government of Punjab, and National Institute of Disaster Management, Government of India, extend a very warm and cordial welcome to the respected dignitaries, speakers, and all the participants in this 3 days online training program on early warning and communication. The training program is directed towards sensitizing, institutionalizing, and promoting exchange of information, knowledge, and innovation on understanding the early warning and communication. Thus, to give you all an exposure on early warning and communication, we have a panel of expertise of the field from NIDM and various other prestigious Indian organizations among us. We have in total 9 sessions over the span of 3 days, and after the end of each session, you are free to ask any question or give any input. You may write in the chat box or you may raise your hand to interact with the faculty. Now, with this note, we move towards the keynote address, for which we have among us a very promising and intellectual personality, Professor Surya Prakash, Head Geometeorological Risks Management Division, NIDM. Sir oversees 3 specialized centers. He's also the nodal officer for coordinating with central ministries, departments, for disaster risk management related planning, research, and capacity building. He has also published several national and international research publications, books, articles in some of the high impact factor journals. A very warm welcome to you, Professor Surya. Surya Prakash, sir, may please have the courtesy to request you for the opening remarks. Professor Surya, the platform is yours.
Thank you, Ms. Nitika ji, for providing me this opportunity. First of all, I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to Director M.G. Sipa for accepting our invitation to collaborate in this program, which is on a very important theme of early warning and communications. As you know, there is a saying in English that a stitch in time saves nine. And similarly, in our disaster management, we state that an early warning is very much helpful in safety of lives of the people which are likely to be affected in any disaster situation. So we have actually from the central level assigned roles and responsibilities as nodal agencies for early warning with respect to different type of hazards. And these central government organizations, they are working day and night to detect, diagnose, and also inform about the potential disasters with a time lag so that the affected population as well as the respective line departments, they can take adequate timely actions to prevent the damages and losses from the potential disasters. So this is what we have been doing since 2005, after the Disaster Management Act was notified on 23rd December 2005. And also subsequently the National Policy on Disaster Management, which was released in October 2009, and the various guidelines on different hazards as well as different functions and operations related to disaster management. I'm very happy that MG Sipa has been supporting us in advocating our programs for disaster risk reduction and resilience very effectively. And it is able to actually spread and disseminate the key messages as well as the vital information to the concerned stakeholders, including the various functionaries at different levels. So this program is one of those programs where we have collaborated with MG Sipa. And I would say ki kisi shayar ne kaha hai ki jagana aata usse kai tarikon se daron par dastak dene khuda nahi aata, jagana aata usse kai tarikon se daron par dastak dene khuda nahi aata, pade raho sahme hue yun hi agar hawaon ke par bandhna nahi aata. So we have to actually learn to tame disasters, and early warning gives us one of those situations, and it has proven well and even applauded by United Nations Disaster Risk Reduction Office, that Government of India, particularly in the hydrometeorological hazards, which are being forecasted by India Meteorological Department, for example, cyclones, we have got a very good success, where in 1999, in super cyclone in Odisha, more than 10,000 casualties had happened, while in the recent cyclones, we have achieved almost zero casualty mission through our efforts for timely early warning, tracking of the cyclones and its landfalls, and as well as the actions at the grassroots levels to evacuate people from the affected areas. So basically, in all such hazards, which we cannot prevent, we have to actually initiate our actions proactively, and we have to prepare against them and respond efficiently. So early warnings provide us an opportunity to deal with them very efficiently, as there is a time lag between the occurrence of the event and the forecast of the event. And on the other hand, our scientists, engineers, and technologists have to actually come up with better and improved versions, as well as economical and affordable versions of our early warning systems. Communications, on the other hand, have also to be redundant. In some places, the communications do fail in the disaster situations. So how we can have alternative communications in case the routine communications fail in disaster situations. So we are coming with satellite phones. We are coming with the video conferencing through satellite communication systems, as well as other dedicated systems like HAMS being used for disaster communications. So NIDM has been conducting such programs also, focusing on communication techniques as well as on early warning. And this is a program where we are clubbing them together, because early warning, until and unless it reaches to the concerned stakeholder, it will be not beneficial. So therefore, communication is equally important. And communication to the last mile and last person, as per our all-inclusive approach, is very, very important. So with these words, I would wish all the best. And I would like to convey my thanks to the distinguished dignitaries of the inaugural program, Secretary Disaster Management, Government of Punjab, as well as Director M.G. Sipa and Colonel Dalbir Singh Ji, Nitika Ji, and all others who are supporting us in conduct of this program. And our team, Dr. Raju Thapa and Dr. Harjeet and Mr. Anil Kathat, and our IT team, as well as our young professionals, Mr. Harihar and Ajit Kathat, who are joining this program along with Dr. Amrit Haldar and Ms. Dipali Jindal. So, and on the other hand, this program would not be successful without the participation of delegates and participants. So we are thankful to them also, but I would urge them to do ask questions to our distinguished experts who will be sharing their knowledge during these 3 days training program. So kindly utilize this time to the maximum possible extent. And also whatever your takeaway lessons are there, that should be implemented in your day-to-day life as well to prevent, to avert, and to reduce the risk from the disasters. So with these words, I thank you very much and wish you all the best. And I convey my personal thanks to all the distinguished experts who have actually accepted our invitations to share their rich knowledge, vast experience, and reliable information, as well as innovative ideas with our delegates and participants. Thank you, one and all. Wish you all the best for the next 3 days for the conduct of this training program. Thank you, Nitik. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Surya Prakash, for gracing this occasion with your immense presence, despite being your busy schedule, sir. Thank you very much, sir. And thank you, sir, for showering your blessings and for this beautiful exposition, sir. Thank you very much, sir. And now I would like to put in place a word of thanks to National Institute of Disaster Management for engaging MACSIPA in their wonderful endeavor. Special thanks to Madam Jaspreet Talwar, DG MACSIPA, and General Manoj Kumar Bindal, ED NIDM, for patroning this training program. In the spirit of Team MACSIPA, our special gratitude to our director, Shri Sibin Singh, and Professor Surya Prakash, Head GMRD Division, NIDM, for their wonderful initiative. Special thanks to Colonel Dilbir Singh and Dr. Raju Thapa, Junior Consultant, NIDM, for facilitating the program and bringing us all together to share and gain through this wonderful program. Last but not the least, thank you all of you for being with us. Now moving towards the technical session, before starting the session, I would like to inform all of you that at the end of each session, you may put forward your questions relevant to the sessions, either by clicking on the raise hand icon, which is available on your screens, or you may post the same in the chat box. Now, starting with the technical sessions, the first session is by Dr. Harjeet from NIDM. Dr. Harjeet is working as junior consultant with NIDM. Madam has published over 16 research publications in reputed international journals. She is a recipient of number of awards, fellowships, and professional recognition, such as Young Scientist Award, and she has been the gold medalist in her undergraduate and postgraduate studies. Now, with this note, may I please request Dr. Harjeet Kaur to enrich our knowledge on understanding disaster risk reduction and resilience through her presentation. Dr. Harjeet, over to you.
Thank you, Nitika, for briefing my introduction. And Just give me a minute so that I can share my PPT. Yeah. I hope my PPT is visible to you.
Yes, Dr. Harjeet, your PPT is visible.
Okay. So today my presentation topic is on understanding of disaster management, or we can say disaster risk reduction and resilience. So before going into technical part, I would like to share coronavirus prevention measures, as it is my duty and this is our mandate. So please wear your mask properly. Wash your hand with alcohol-based sanitizer, or you can use water and soap. Please keep the social distance and clean surface regularly. Now, moving ahead, the presentation, the main objective of my presentation is we will going to discuss about the various definition, terminologies and type relevant to various disasters. And here we will try to understand what is disaster and how it impact on society and their cause. And I will try to provide the information on the conceptual aspect of disaster management. तो जैसे कि आप इस इमेजेस में देख रहे हो, मैंने बहुत सारी फोटो शेयर की हैं, जैसे कि फ्लड की शेयर की हुई है ना, फायर की है, अर्थक्वेक आफ्टर अर्थक्वेक बिल्डिंग कोलैप्स हो गई है, और साइक्लोन भी है. तो हमारी जो कंट्री है बहुत सारे डिजास्टर से इफेक्टेड है ना. तो हमें अब समझना है कि व्हाट इज हैजार्ड. तो हैजार्ड की एक स्टैंडर्ड डेफिनेशन है, जो कि है कि हैजार्ड इज अ रेयर और एक्सट्रीम नेचुरल और ह्यूमन मेड इवेंट दैट थ्रेटन्स टू एडवर्सली अफेक्ट ह्यूमन लाइफ प्रॉपर्टी एक्टिविटी टू द एक्सटेंड ऑफ कॉजिंग डिजास्टर. और हम इस हैजार्ड की कैरेक्टराइजेशन कैसे करते हैं किसी इवेंट को, अगर ये इवेंट हो रहा है तो हम कैसे उसे हैजार्ड कहेंगे किसी भी इवेंट को. जैसे कि हमें पता है कि कोई भी जब इवेंट होता है और अचानक से उसमें बहुत सारी डैमेजेस होंगी, लाइफ लॉस होगा, डिस्ट्रक्शन टू एनवायरनमेंट होगा, तब हम कहते हैं कि हाँ ये हैजार्ड है. तो सिमिलरली हमें इस चीज को कैरेक्टराइज करना है किसी भी इवेंट को. तो किस कैसे पता चलेगा, अगर किसी भी इवेंट से हमें लॉसेस होते हैं, इकोनॉमिक डिस्ट्रक्शन होता है, एनवायरमेंटल डिग्रेडेशन होता है, प्रॉपर्टी डैमेज होती है, तब हम किसी भी इवेंट को हैजार्ड कहते हैं. तो ये हैजार्ड को कैरेक्टराइज करने के कुछ पॉइंट है. यहाँ आप इस टेबल में देख सकते हो कि मैंने आपके साथ शेयर किया है हमारे जो मेन हैजार्ड हैं जो हमारी कंट्री को इफेक्ट कर रहे हैं. ठीक है, तो पहले नंबर पे आता है फ्लड है, साइक्लोन है, हीट वेव है, थंडरस्टॉर्म है, ड्रॉट है, अर्थक्वेक है ना, लैंडस्लाइड है, सुनामी है. तो फ्लड के केस में हम देख सकते हैं कि जो 40 मिलियन हेक्टेयर ऑफ लैंड मास है, दैट इज अफेक्टेड बाय द फ्लड हैजार्ड. देन फॉर द साइक्लोन, द बे ऑफ बंगाल एंड अरेबियन सी पार्ट इज अफेक्टेड बाय द साइक्लोन्स. The western and northwestern regions and also our Bihar and UP is affected by heat wave, cold wave and fog. And through the central and the northeastern or the northwestern parts are affected by the thunderstorm, hailstorm, dust storm. And drought region, obviously the arid and semi-arid and sub-arid areas of our countries is affected by the drought. And the Himalayan sub-Himalayan belt, Andaman, Nicobar islands are affected by the earthquake hazards. And similarly, for landslides, the Himalayan and sub-Himalayan belt or Andaman, Nicobar belt is vulnerable for landslide hazards. So for tsunami, the east and the west coast of India and the island region are likely to be affected by the tsunami generated mainly by the subduction zone related to earthquake from the two potential sources, and that is our Andaman Nicobar Sumatra Island arc and the Makran subduction zone of north of Arabian Sea. So this is all about the main hazard and how these hazard impact on our country region wise. अब हमें पता करना है कि क्योंकि जो सिचुएशन होती है, इवेंट होता है, हम जनरली हम ये वर्ड यूज करते हैं यार, इमरजेंसी हो गई, तो हम कैसे कहते हैं इमरजेंसी? सो द स्टैंडर्ड डेफिनेशन ऑफ इमरजेंसी इज अ सिचुएशन जनरेटेड बाय द रियल और द इमिनेंट ऑकरेंस ऑफ एन इवेंट दैट रिक्वायर्स द इमीडिएट अटेंशन. और हम जनरली जो हैजार्ड है वो दैट कैन बिकम एन एमरजेंसी व्हेन द एमरजेंसी मूव बियॉन्ड द कंट्रोल ऑफ द पॉपुलेशन एंड इट बिकम्स अ डिजास्टर. अब यहाँ पे हमें एक अटेंशन पे करने को है क्योंकि दैट इवेंट और अ सिचुएशन व्हिच वी आर डिस्क्राइब इन द डेफिनेशन दैट कैन जनरेट अ नेगेटिव कॉन्सिक्वेंसेस और एस्केलेट into an emergency. So the purpose of our planning, our preparedness is to minimize those consequences, that is our negative consequences. Now, the vulnerability. आप इस इमेज में देख सकते हो कि यहाँ पे हमने बहुत सारे words का एक club है, ठीक है, जिसमें capacity word use हो रहा है, human use हो रहा है, reduction है, exposure है, community है, environment है. तो इस चीजों इन words का जो stand मतलब जो outcome आता है that is our vulnerability. तो ये बहुत ही अच्छी image है, इन scientists ने use किया है to define the definition of vulnerability. तो vulnerability की standard definition क्या है? अगर हम इन सब वर्ड्स को फ्रेम आउट करते हैं एक डेफिनेशन में, तो वल्नरेबिलिटी की डेफिनेशन होती है द डिग्री ऑफ लॉस टू अ गिवन एलिमेंट एट रिस्क रिजल्टिंग फ्रॉम द ऑकरेंस ऑफ अ नेचुरल फेनोमेना और फ्रॉम एंथ्रोपोजेनिक फेनोमेना ऑफ अ गिवन मैग्नीट्यूड. एंड वल्नरेबिलिटी इज एक्सप्रेस्ड ऑन द स्केल फ्रॉम 0 to 1, वेयर 0 रिप्रेजेंट द लोअर वल्नरेबिलिटी एंड 1 रिप्रेजेंट द हायर वल्नरेबिलिटी. अब जब भी अगर बेसिक क्वेश्चन है कि अगर हमने वल्नरेबिलिटी असेसमेंट करनी है तो हमें दो चीजों को कैलकुलेट करना है. पहले तो हमें असेस करना है कि वल्नरेबल पॉपुलेशन क्या है, ठीक है, और दूसरा है कि वल्नरेबल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर क्या है, हु एंड व्हाट. अगर हमें इस हु और व्हाट को अगर हम वी आर एबल टू फाइंड आउट, सो वी कैन इजिली फाइंड आउट द वल्नरेबिलिटी फॉर एनी जियोग्राफिकल रीजन. अब कुछ स्टैंडर्ड मेथड्स हैं टाइप ऑफ वल्नरेबिलिटीज के. डिफरेंट डिफरेंट साइंटिस्ट हैव यूज्ड डिफरेंट मेथडोलॉजी टू डिफाइन क्लासिफाई दी वल्नरेबिलिटी. तो द बेसिक प्रिंसिपल बिहाइंड दैट कि उन लोगों ने जो भी हम वल्नरेबल पॉपुलेशन हो या इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर हो, हम उसे डिवाइड करते हैं इनटेंजिबल एंड इनटेंजिबल मटेरियल में. तो टेंजिबल में क्या आता है? That we can easily see, we can easily determine their value, है ना? जैसे example क्या क्या हो गए? People हो गया, हमारा life, health, security, our living condition, फिर ये हमारा जो people who हो गया ना, है ना? That is our social. अब physical में property आ जाएगी, हमारे infrastructures आ जाएंगे, road, transportation line, environment में water, soil, vegetation, wildlife. और इनटेंजिबल में क्या होता है? दैट इज डिफिकल्ट टू सी एंड डिफिकल्ट टू डिटरमाइन. तो इसमें क्या क्या है? जैसे हमारे जो सोशल स्ट्रक्चरल हो गए, जो साइकोलॉजिकल स्ट्रेस होता है, आर कल्चरल प्रैक्टिसेस आल्सो. सो दीस आर अंडर द क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ वल्नरेबिलिटी. अब ये बेसिक प्रिंसिपल हो गया कि हमने किस तरीके से किसी भी एलिमेंट को वल्नरेबिलिटी में क्लासिफाई करना है. अब बेसिक जो मोस्टली रिसर्च पेपर्स में जो साइंटिस्ट या यंगस्टर यंग प्रोफेशनल्स यूज करते हैं टाइप वल्नरेबिलिटी की, वो है फिजिकल, सोशल, इकोनॉमिक एंड पॉलिटिकल वल्नरेबिलिटी. तो फिजिकल में क्या हो जाएंगे हमारे एलिमेंट, इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर आ जाएंगे, हमारे बिल्डिंग्स है ना, हमारा हाउस हो जाएगा, रोड लाइन हो जाएगी, ट्रांसपोर्टेशन सिस्टम जिसे हम कहते हैं, फिर सोशल वल्नर, इवन डैम वगैरह. आपका जो जियोग्राफिकल रीजन है उस हिसाब से आप अपने एरिया की फिजिकल वल्नरेबिलिटी को क्लासिफाई कर सकते हैं. अब हम सोशल वल्नरेबिलिटी की बात करते हैं तो ऑब्वियसली सोशल में हम पॉपुलेशन को करते हैं. अब पॉपुलेशन मेन फोकस्ड हो गया. अब पॉपुलेशन को भी आप डिफरेंटली क्लासिफाई कर सकते हैं, कौन सी लाइक एज वाइज आप उसे क्लासिफाई कर सकते हैं. ओल्ड एज ग्रुप हो गया है ना, यंगस्टर हो गया, चिल्ड्रंस हो गए. तो इस प्रकार से आप अपनी जो वल्नरेबिलिटी फॉर अकॉर्डिंग टू द पॉपुलेशन आप उसे क्लासिफाई कर सकते हो अपने मैप को. फिर आप इकोनॉमिक वल्नरेबिलिटी पे कैसे हम इसे काउंट करेंगे, जैसे कि अब हमारे जैसे रोड इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर है तो इसमें हमें अगर डैमेजेस होती हैं तो हमें बहुत कॉस्ट, हमारा लॉस होता है, इकोनॉमिक लॉसेस होता है. अगर अगर दिल्ली में मान लीजिए अर्थक्वेक होता है और यहाँ पे हमारे मेनली ऑल द सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट, इवन आर पार्लियामेंट हाउस, एवरीथिंग इज देयर, तो हमें बहुत इकोनॉमिक लॉसेस होगा. उस तरीके से हमने अपने बिल्डिंग को क्लासीफाई करना है. फिर पॉलिटिकल वल्नरेबिलिटी, इसमें क्या है कि अगर उस टाइम में असेंबलीज वगैरह चल रही हूँ तो वो भी, इवन हमारा जो सिक्किम अर्थक्वेक हुआ था 2011 में, वहां पे अगर जो वहां से रिलेटेड है उन्हें पता है कि गैंगटॉक में जो उनका असेंबली हाउस था वो पूरा का पूरा ही डैमेज हो चुका था अर्थक्वेक की वजह से, तो वो एक सेटबैक है हमें. तो इस प्रकार से हमें अपने टाइप ऑफ वल्नरेबिलिटी को, हमारे जो एलिमेंट्स है, हमारे जो फैक्टर्स है, उसे हमें क्लासीफाई करना है. अब नेक्स्ट मेथड्स क्या क्या हैं, ठीक है. जब आफ्टर द क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ आर फैक्टर्स फॉर द वल्नरेबिलिटी, वी नीड टू एनालाइज वल्नरेबिलिटी थ्रू साइंटिफिक अप्रोच, स्टैंडर्ड साइंटिफिक अप्रोच. तो बहुत सारे साइंटिस्ट डिफरेंट डिफरेंट मेथडोलॉजी यूज करते हैं. तो जैसे कुछ वल्नरेबिलिटी मैट्रिसेस यूज करते हैं, कुछ इंडिकेटर मेथडोलॉजी यूज करते हैं, और कुछ कर्व के थ्रू भी वल्नरेबिलिटी को रिप्रेजेंट करते हैं. तो हियर आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू एक्सप्लेन द डिटेल अबाउट द डिफरेंट टाइप ऑफ मेथड्स. हियर आई एम जस्ट हाईलाइटिंग दीज पॉइंट्स. अब सेंट्रल क्वेश्चन, जैसे कि मैंने आपको पहले बताया कि अगर हम किसी भी एरिया का वल्नरेबिलिटी असेसमेंट के लिए जाते हैं तो हमें ये क्वेश्चन कुछ हमारे बेसिक माइंड में रहना चाहिए ताकि हम वल्नरेबिलिटी को एनालाइज कर सके उस एरिया के लिए. तो ये कुछ बेसिक क्वेश्चंस हैं, हु इज वल्नरेबल, व्हाई दे आर वल्नरेबल, एंड हाउ दे आर वल्नरेबल, एंड हाउ इंस्टीट्यूशन कंट्रीब्यूट टू वल्नरेबिलिटी. तो इन क्वेश्चंस अगर जो भी रिसर्चर अपने जाते हैं तो they can prepare research methodology and they can prepare the different type of question relevant to their research studies. अब यहाँ पे जो scientist हैं उन्होंने बहुत ही अच्छे से एक assessment, vulnerability assessment का flow chart दिया है जो कि बहुत ही simple और basics है. अगर आप vulnerability assess करते हो, हमें टाइप्स पता चल गए हैं, अब हमें एसेस करना है हम किस बेसिस पे एक्सेस करेंगे वल्नरेबिलिटी को. तो पहले तो हमें हु आर वल्नरेबल ना, तो हमें एक्सपोजर देखना है कि उस एरिया का, कि ये जो पॉपुलेशन है इस एरिया के पास में या कोई साइस्मिक जोन इतने में रहता है, तो दीज मच ऑफ पॉपुलेशन इज अंडर द एक्सपोजर टू लैंडस्लाइड और अर्थक्वेक या किसी भी पर्टिकुलर हैजार्ड के लिए या फ्लड या साइक्लोन के लिए भी जो कोस्टल एरिया के पास में. तो वो हम एक्सपोजर देखेंगे, फिर सेंसिटिविटी देखेंगे. अब सेंसिटिविटी में हम एक पॉपुलेशन का, मैं जस्ट एग्जांपल देती हूँ कि जो स्लम एरियाज हैं, ठीक है, तो वो ऑब्वियसली दोज पॉपुलेशन आर अंडर द सेंसिटिव ग्रुप. तो इस प्रकार से आपको अपने वल्नरेबिलिटी डेटा को एनालाइज करना पड़ेगा कि कौन सी पॉपुलेशन अंडर सेंसिटिविटी है, या फिर आपका जो पॉपुलेशन आपने एज वाइज जो क्लासीफाई किया है आप उसको भी, जो कि ओल्ड एज ग्रुप है ना, जो वीडोज को भी आप क्लासीफाई कर सकते हो, जो डिजेबल पर्सन है आप उनको भी, क्योंकि दे आर नॉट एबल टू कोप अप विद दैट पर्टिकुलर इवेंट, तो वो सेंसिटिव आ जाएंगे. अब एडेप्टिव कैपेसिटी, क्योंकि हमारी कैपेसिटी है कि हम उससे फाइट बैक कर पाते हैं कि नहीं, तो इस अगर ये तीनों चीज हो और एक्सपोजर और सेंसिटिविटी जो भी इम्पैक्ट करे और अपनी हम कैपेसिटी ऐड करते हैं, देन वी आर एबल टू असेस द वल्नरेबिलिटी फॉर अ पर्टिकुलर जियोग्राफिकल रीजन. अब हम यहाँ पे आफ्टर वल्नरेबिलिटी हमें डिजास्टर के बारे में पता करना है, क्योंकि हम पहले तो इवेंट हुआ है ना, कोई भी इवेंट है तो हम उसे जल्दी से हैजार्ड नहीं कह सकते जब तक उसमें लाइफ लॉसेस वगैरह ना हो, ठीक है. और जो हैजार्ड है वो नेचुरल भी हो सकते हैं, एंथ्रोपोजेनिक भी हो सकते हैं, ठीक है. तो अब डिजास्टर है, तो डिजास्टर की स्टैंडर्ड डेफिनेशन क्या है कि इज अ कंसिक्वेंस ऑफ अ सडन डिजास्टरस इवेंट विच सीरियसली डिसरप्ट द नॉर्मल फंक्शन ऑफ द सोसाइटी और द कम्युनिटी टू द एक्सटेंट दैट इट कैन नॉट सर्वाइव विदाउट द आउटसाइड हेल्प, ठीक है. तो इसे हम डिजास्टर कहते हैं. हम किस भी डिजास्टर को हम हैजार्ड नहीं कह सकते. जैसे कुछ लोग बहुत क्वेश्चन पूछते हैं इस चीज को लेके कि हैजार्ड कैन बी अ डिजास्टर, तो एकदम सिंपल सी बात है कि डिजास्टर कभी भी हैजार्ड नहीं होता, ठीक है. लेकिन हैजार्ड कैन बी अ डिजास्टर. क्यों? अगर समझ लीजिए कि एक अर्थक्वेक हो रहा है एकदम बैरन लैंड पे जहाँ कोई पॉपुलेशन नहीं है, कोई घर नहीं है वहां पे, अगर आप अपने रेगिस्तान एरिया की बात करो, तो ऑब्वियसली हम उस हैजार्ड को कंसिडर नहीं करते हैं जब तक लाइफ लॉस वगैरह इकोनॉमिक लॉसेस ना हो. तो ये एक बेसिक सिंपल एग्जाम्पल था. अब नेक्स्ट है कि हम किसी भी सिचुएशन को हम कैसे डिस्टिंग्विश करते हैं, डिस्टिंग्विश बिटवीन द एमरजेंसी एंड द डिजास्टर सिचुएशन. तो ये जो दोनों ही इट्स अ टू डिफरेंट सिचुएशन वेयर एन एमरजेंसी इज अ सिचुएशन इन विच द कम्युनिटी इज कैपेबल ऑफ कोपिंग एंड इट इज अ सिचुएशन जनरेटेड बाय द रियल और इमिनेंट ऑकरेंस ऑफ एन इवेंट दैट रिक्वायर्स इमीडिएट अटेंशन एंड दैट रिक्वायर इमीडिएट सॉरी दैट रिक्वायर द इमीडिएट अटेंशन ऑफ अ एमरजेंसी रिसोर्सेज. एंड वेयर एज अ डिजास्टर इज अ सिचुएशन इन विच द कम्युनिटी इज इनकैपेबल ऑफ कोपिंग. तो ये एक बेसिक डिफरेंस है एक डिजास्टर सिचुएशन का और इमरजेंसी सिचुएशन में. And a disaster is a natural or a human-caused event which causes intense negative impacts on people, goods, services, and the environment. Ab, this is the image or figure that shows the stages in the evaluation of disaster. तो आप इस इमेज में देख सकते हो कि डिजास्टर कब हो रहा है, हैजार्ड है, वल्नरेबिलिटी है, फिर रिस्क है, आपकी कैपेसिटी है, रेजिलियंस है. तो ये जो पूरे अगर हम बात करते हैं कि डिजास्टर में क्या क्या इवॉल्व होती हैं चीजें, तो ये बेसिक चीज है जहां मैंने कंपोनेंट ए बी सी करके लिखा हुआ है, देन इट विल क्रिएट अ डिजास्टर जबकि हम आउट ऑफ जो सिचुएशन को हैंडल नहीं कर सकते हैं. तो ये बहुत ही अच्छा डायग्राम है, साइंटिस्ट ने यूज किया है. अब जैसे कि मैंने आपको डिस्कस कर ही रही थी कि हमें हैजार्ड डिजास्टर वल्नरेबिलिटी को डिस्टिंग्विश मतलब ऐसा हमें बनना है कि हम वी कैन इजीली आइडेंटिफाई दीज थिंग्स. तो आप जैसे ये एक इमेज मैं आपको शो कर रही हूँ जिससे कि आप इजीली डिस्टिंग्विश कर सकते हो कि कौन जो पॉपुलेशन है वो वल्नरेबिलिटी क्या है, ठीक है. इट मे बी अ फिजिकल वल्नरेबिलिटी और इट मे बी अ सोशल वल्नरेबिलिटी. फिर डिजास्टर क्या है, ठीक है. तो आप इस फर्स्ट वाली जो राइट हैंड सॉरी लेफ्ट हैंड साइड की जो फर्स्ट इमेज है आप उसमें देख सकते हो कि एक आदमी है जो एक हिलॉक के इधर बोल्डर के पास में खड़ा है. तो जब तक ये खड़ा है ये क्या है एक्सपोजर में, जैसे आप कैसे फाइंड आउट करोगे, तो ये जो आदमी है ये वल्नरेबल है. अगर फिर आप उसको फर्दर क्लासिफाई करते हो तो ये सोशल वल्नरेबिलिटी की कैटेगरी में आ जाता है ना. नेक्स्ट आप इसके ठीक डायगोनली जो इमेज है जिसमें ये एफ और जी लिखा हुआ है इसमें आप घर को देख सकते हो, है ना. तो ये अगर यहाँ लैंडस्लाइड होता है, अगर होता है पॉसिबिलिटी है ना प्रोबेबिलिटी, तो ऑब्वियसली ये जो घर है वो डैमेज हो जाएगा, डिस्ट्रक्ट हो जाएगा, ठीक है. तो ये एक्सपोजर में है. तो ये जो अब आप इसको फर्दर क्लासिफाई करते हो तो ये फिजिकल वल्नरेबिलिटी हो गई, है ना. फिर आप इसके ठीक है फर्स्ट इमेज के राइट हैंड साइड में आप देख सकते हो जहां सी लिखा है ये बोल्डर गिर गया और इस आदमी की डेथ हो गई, देन इट विल क्रिएट अ डिजास्टर. तो हमें इस प्रकार से vulnerability, hazard और disaster के words को distinguish, हमें ऐसा बनना है, we are need to capable to distinguish all these three terminologies. और मैं आशा करती हूँ कि शायद इस इमेज के थ्रू आप इजीली डिस्टिंग्विश कर सकोगे इन तीनों चीजों को. अब कैटेगरीज की बात करते हैं, तो ये आप यहाँ देख सकते हो कि नेचुरल हैजार्ड्स जो कैटेगरी है 5 क्लासेस में डिफाइन किया हुआ है, जियोफिजिकल, हाइड्रोलॉजिकल, क्लाइमेटोलॉजिकल, मेट्रोलॉजिकल एंड बायोलॉजिकल. अब हम जैसे कि प्राइमरली वी सपोज दैट द डिजास्टर आर ट्रिगर्ड बाय द नेचुरल हैजार्ड्स और ह्यूमन इंड्यूस्ड और रिजल्ट फ्रॉम द कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ द बोथ. एंड हियर यू कैन सी वी हैव कंसिडर्ड द अर्थक्वेक, मास मूवमेंट ऑफ अर्थ मटीरियल, वॉल्केनो, सुनामीज आर अंडर द क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ जियोफिजिकल. Then flood, landslide, wave action are classified under the hydrological, hydrological hazards, and the climatological hazards are drought, extreme hot cold condition, forest fire or wildfire we can say, glacial lake outburst, subsidence. These are under the category of climatological hazards. And meteorological hazards are cyclone, storm surge, cold wave, extreme temperature, fog, frost, freeze. And the biological hazards are the epidemics, insect, animal stampedes. These are under the classification of biological hazards. Yeah. अब ये इससे पहले जो मैंने आपके साथ डिस्कस किया क्लासिफिकेशन 5 टाइप ऑफ नेचुरल हैजार्ड्स की, वो दैट इज developed by the NDMP through, sorry, that is classified by the under NDMP 2016. And this disaster classification is identified by the High Power Committee. तो इन्होंने भी disaster को 5 classes में identify किया हुआ है, but they have used different terminologies. जैसे कि flood वहाँ पे hydrology में है, और जो साइक्लोन है वो अलग कैटेगरी में है मेट्रोलॉजिकल वाले में. तो यहाँ पे इन लोगों ने, हाई पावर कमिटी ने, वाटर एंड क्लाइमेट रिलेटेड डिजास्टर में फ्लड, साइक्लोन, टोर्नेडो, हेलस्टॉर्म, क्लाउडबर्स्ट, हीट वेव, स्नो एवलांचेस, ड्रॉट, सी इरोजन, थंडर्स एंड लाइटनिंग, सुनामीज, सो दीज आर अंडर द क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ वाटर एंड क्लाइमेट रिलेटेड डिजास्टर. अब जियोलॉजिकली रिलेटेड डिजास्टर्स आर लैंडस्लाइड, मड फ्लो, अर्थक्वेक, डैम फेलियर, डैम बर्स्ट एंड माइन फायर, वेयर एज द न्यूक्लियर डिजास्टर आर अंडर द कैटेगरी ऑफ CBRN. फिर बायोलॉजिकल रिलेटेड डिजास्टर क्या क्या है, पेस्ट अटैक दे हैव क्लासिफाइड, कैटल एपिडेमिक्स, फूड पॉइजनिंग, बायोलॉजिकल डिजास्टर. सो ये सारे बायोलॉजिकल रिलेटेड डिजास्टर है. एंड डिफरेंट आप देख सकते हो उसमें जो प्रीवियस हमने जो NDMP के अकॉर्डिंग टू जो क्लासिफिकेशन है उसमें एक्सीडेंट रिलेटेड डिजास्टर नहीं है. तो हाई पावर कमिटी ने एक्सीडेंट रिलेटेड डिजास्टर में क्या क्लासिफाई किया हुआ है, फॉरेस्ट फायर को किया है, अर्बन फायर को किया हुआ है, माइन फ्लडिंग को किया हुआ है, ऑयल स्पिल जितने हो गए, मेजर बिल्डिंग कोलैप्स हो गए, फेस्टिवल रिलेटेड डिजास्टर जैसे क्राउड डिजास्टर आजकल ये टर्म चल रहा है, एयर, रोड एंड रेल रिलेटेड डिजास्टर्स, विलेज फायर, बोट कैप्साइजिंग. तो ये सारे जितने भी क्लासिफाई किए हैं डिजास्टर अंडर द कैटेगरी ऑफ एक्सीडेंट रिलेटेड. अब जो डिजास्टर की स्टैंडर्ड डेफिनेशन है दैट हैज गिवन बाय द यूनिसेडार इन 2009, वेयर दे हैव डिफाइन डिजास्टर एज अ सीरियस डिसरप्शन ऑफ द फंक्शनिंग ऑफ अ कम्युनिटी और अ सोसाइटी इन्वॉल्विंग वाइड स्प्रेड ह्यूमन, मटीरियल, इकोनॉमिक और द एनवायरमेंटल लॉसेज एंड इम्पैक्ट्स विच एक्सीड द एबिलिटी ऑफ द अफेक्टेड कम्युनिटी और अ सोसाइटी टू कोप यूजिंग इट्स ओन रिसोर्सेज. And the DM Act has defined disaster as a catastrophe, mishap, calamity or a grave occurrence in any area arising from the natural or a man-made cause or by accident or a negligence which result in substantially loss of life or a human suffering or a damage to and destruction of the property, damage or degradation of environment, and this such nature or the magnitude as to be beyond the coping capacity of the community of the affected area. So both these definitions are, you can see the different, but the meaning is same. So basically, we follow the disaster standard definition by the UNICEDAR and DMF 2005. Now, we have previously discussed natural hazard. Now, we're going to discuss about the human-induced disaster. So according to NDMP, they have notes these two desire as a human-induced disaster. So ye hai CBRN, that is the chemical, biological, radiological, and nuclear hazards, and fire. Ab hum level of disaster discuss karenge ki kis tarah se NDMP ne disaster ke level ko define kiya hua hai. To inhone char category mein divide kiya hua hai level ke level of disaster. These are from L0 to L3. So here L0 is indicating to be utilized for disaster risk reduction, that is the period of normalcy. Then here level 1 indicates the level of disaster that can be managed within the capabilities and the resource at district level, hai na, aur jahan ki state authorities active rahengi, ready rahengi unhe assistance dene ke liye agar unhe zarurat padti hai. To level 2 mein kya hai इसमें this situation signifies the disaster situation that require assistance and active mobilization of resources at state level. तो L1 में क्या था, district level हो रहा है, L2 में state level हो रहा है, और यहाँ पे L2 में central agencies होंगी, वो ready रहेंगी अगर state को कोई भी जरूरत पड़ती है तो. Then L3 correspond to a nearly catastrophic situation or a very large scale disaster that overwhelms the state and district authorities, and the categorization of disaster situation into the level. But these level have no mention in the DMF 2005. Ab aap is map ko dekh sakte ho, it's a table. मैंने मतलब किसी भी आप मैप का देखते हो हैजार्ड वल्नरेबिलिटी या रिस्क मैप, तो उसको हमने जो उसका इंडेक्स होता है, लीजेंट होता है बेसिकली, वो हाई टू लो रिप्रेजेंट करता है. तो अब हम इसी का एग्जांपल लेके अगर आप पर्टिकुलरली फॉर हिल एरिया देख सकते हो, तो वहां पे हाई रिस्क हैजार्ड क्या है, अर्थक्वेक है ना, फायर है, टेररिस्ट अटैक इतनी नहीं है, बट आप वहां लैंडस्लाइड को हम हाई रिस्क की कैटेगरी में डाल सकते हो अगर हिल एरिया में देखते हो तो. फिर नेक्स्ट, या फिर आप मीडियम रिस्क में क्या क्या एक्सीडेंट हो सकते हैं हिल एरिया के एग्जांपल के लिए, है ना, एपिडेमिक्स ऑब्वियसली हो सकता है, रोड एक्सीडेंट होते हैं, रेल एक्सीडेंट को हम लो हैजार्ड की कैटेगरी में डाल सकते हैं फॉर हिल एरिया के लिए. और यहाँ पे लो रिस्क हैजार्ड में क्या हो जाएंगे, जो रिलीजियस राइट हो गए, है ना. तो इस प्रकार से किसी भी जियोग्राफिकल रीजन के लिए पहले तो हमें हैजार्ड को क्लासिफाई एंड आइडेंटिफाई करना पड़ेगा. अब हम कैपेसिटी की बात करेंगे. हमने डिजास्टर के साथ जितनी भी डेफिनेशन और डिफरेंट टर्म्स थे वो हमने जान लिया. अब हमें है कि नोट अबाउट द कैपेसिटी. सो कैपेसिटी इज द कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ ऑल द स्ट्रेंथ एट्रीब्यूट्स एंड द रिसोर्सेज अवेलेबल विद इन एन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन और इन अ कम्युनिटी और अ सोसाइटी टू मैनेज एंड रिड्यूस द डिजास्टर रिस्क एंड स्ट्रेंथन द रेजिलियंस. और एक लाइन में हम कैपेसिटी को डिफाइन कर सकते हैं, एबिलिटी ऑफ कोपिंग एंड responding to reduce the losses. अब रिस्क को हम किस प्रकार से स्पेसिफिक रिस्क को हम कैलकुलेट कर सकते हैं. जैसा कि हमें पता है कि रिस्क इज द प्रोडक्ट ऑफ हैजार्ड, वल्नरेबिलिटी एंड एक्सपोजर. ठीक है, तो अब स्पेसिफिक आप इन जनरल आप रिस्क पर्टिकुलर किसी भी एरिया का निकाल दो, है ना. अब जब स्पेसिफिक रिस्क की बात आ जाती है तो हमें जैसे आप यहाँ इस फॉर्मूला में देख रहे हो हैजार्ड, तो हैजार्ड तो बहुत सारे हैं ना. जी मैंने आपको 5 कैटेगरीज के हैजार्ड्स बताए हैं. तो जब स्पेसिफिक हम आ जाते हो तो हमें अर्थक्वेक हैजार्ड के लिए करना है रिस्क निकालना है, और हमें लैंडस्लाइड के लिए रिस्क निकालना है, कि हमें साइक्लोन के लिए रिस्क निकालना है. तो स्पेसिफिक रिस्क में हमें वो चीज़ अपने माइंड में रखना पड़ेगा. यहाँ पे मान लो कि हम अर्थक्वेक के लिए ले रहे हैं, तो वी नीड टू प्रिपेयर द मैप फॉर द अर्थक्वेक हैजार्ड. देन वी नीड टू प्रिपेयर द और वी कैन असेस द एक्सपोजर ऑफ द पॉपुलेशन ऑफ दैट पर्टिकुलर हिल एरिया. Then we need to calculate the vulnerability, who are vulnerable and what is vulnerable. तो हमें इस चीज इस प्रकार से अपने मैप बनाने पड़ेंगे अगर we are focusing for the specific risk. अब element at risk, जैसे कि मैंने आपको previous slides में बताया हुआ है कि जो भी exposure, even जो population है ना, vulnerability की definition में बताया. तो basically एलिमेंट एट रिस्क क्या हो गया, हमारी पॉपुलेशन हो गई, प्रॉपर्टीज हो गई, इकोनॉमिक एक्टिविटीज हो गई, है ना. तो ये सब एट जो भी रिस्क में है वो सब एलिमेंट एट रिस्क है. तो इसको हम इस इमेज के माध्यम से समझने की कोशिश करेंगे कि एलिमेंट एट रिस्क क्या क्या है. तो बेसिकली अगर हमें जब भी वल्नरेबिलिटी या हमें रिस्क को एनालाइज करना है तो हम ऑब्वियसली थ्रू मैप के माध्यम से करेंगे, क्योंकि हम मतलब लार्ज स्केल डेटा होता है. तो आप किस तरीके से एक बिल्डिंग का फुटप्रिंट प्रिपेयर करोगे, तो बेसिकली द जीआईएस साइंटिस्ट और द रिसर्चर दे यूज्ड टू प्रिपेयर द मैप फॉर द बिल्डिंग फुटप्रिंट मैप. तो आप और हमें वी नीड टू परचेज सैटेलाइट इमेजरी ऑफ दैट पर्टिकुलर रीजन. तो ये एक कोस्टल एरिया का सैटेलाइट इमेजरी है जैसे कि आप देख सकते हो. तो यहाँ पे नॉर्मली हमें मास्टर क्लासेस में सिखाया जाता है और इन बीएससी लेवल की हम किस तरीके से एक सैटेलाइट इमेजरी को आइडेंटिफाई कर सकते हैं. तो ये ऑब्वियसली ये ट्रू कलर इमेजरी है, तो क्योंकि इसमें आपको ट्रू कलर दिख रहे हैं. वेजिटेशन को ग्रीन से रिप्रेजेंट किया हुआ है एंड दिस वाइट पैचेस, ये जो है ये तो क्लाउड कवर है. आप इसको नहीं, मैं इस साइड की बात कर रही हूँ इमेज में. तो ये जो होते हैं ये इट रिप्रेजेंट दी हैबिटेट और द रेसिडेंशियल एरियाज. ये दीज स्क्वायर पैचेस इंडिकेट्स द एग्रीकल्चर लैंड एंड दीज स्ट्रेट लाइन्स आई थिंक this is airport and these straight lines are the transportation or the road line. ठीक है, तो obviously this if a cyclone hits this coastal area, so these population for physical vulnerability, social vulnerability and the economic vulnerability, environmental vulnerability we can analyze for this map. तो इसीलिए अगर आप हिल एरिया के लिए करते हो तो हमें उस एरिया के लिए पर्टिकुलरली सैटेलाइट इमेजरी चाहिए. आप आफ्टर दिस इमेजरी क्लासिफिकेशन हो गया, आपने एक अपने माइंड में कर लिया कि मुझे इस प्रकार से अपने वल्नरेबिलिटी, मुझे इस मैप से 5 टाइप की वल्नरेबिलिटी यू आर एबल टू आइडेंटिफाई फ्रॉम दिस सैटेलाइट इमेजरी. अब हमें ये इसे कहते हैं हम बिल्डिंग फुटप्रिंट मैप. तो आप यहाँ देख सकते हो कि इस टेबल में दिया हुआ है कि टाइप ऑफ लेयर किस प्रकार से इन्होंने यूज किया हुआ. जैसे पॉलीगोनल से हम किसी भी बिल्डिंग्स को मार्क करते हैं और लाइन के थ्रू हम जितने भी रोड लाइन हो गया, है ना, रेल लाइन हो गया, रिवर हो गई, हम उसको स्ट्रेट लाइन से ड्रॉ करते हैं, रिप्रेजेंट करते हैं. इस प्रकार से हमें अपनी स्टडी एरिया के लिए एलिमेंट एट रिस्क का मैप बनाना पड़ेगा जिसको हम बिल्डिंग फुटप्रिंट मैप कहते हैं. अब क्लासिफिकेशन ऑब्वियसली डिफरेंट साइंटिस्ट हैज यूज्ड डिफरेंट क्लासिफिकेशन मेथड टू क्लासिफाई द एलिमेंट एट रिस्क. टाइम मैं एक्सीड कर रही हूँ तो मैं जल्दी जल्दी कवर करने की कोशिश करूंगी। हाँ तो अब ये जो स्लाइड है यहाँ पे मैं बेसिकली आपको इन जनरल बताना चाहती हूँ कि आप किस प्रकार से रिस्क मैनेजमेंट हम करेंगे। अगर हम बीइंग अ साइंटिस्ट अगर आपको रिस्क मैनेजमेंट या रिस्क एनालिसिस करना है फॉर अ पर्टिकुलर जियोग्राफिकल रीजन तो फर्स्ट थिंग कि हमें ये बेसिक जो ये आइडिया है ये इन्होंने आईटीसी नीदरलैंड ने डेवलप किया हुआ है तो फर्स्ट आपको हैजार्ड असेसमेंट करनी होगी उस एरिया के लिए, फिर आपको एलिमेंट एट रिस्क का डेटाबेस बनाना पड़ेगा, फिर वल्नरेबिलिटी असेसमेंट करनी होगी, फिर आपको जैसे नॉर्मली पता है कि जो रिस्क है दैट इज द प्रोडक्ट ऑफ दीज थ्री थिंग्स तो आपको उस एरिया का रिस्क मैप मिल जाएगा। फिर आफ्टर दी आपको जो रिस्क मैप आपके एरिया का मिल गया है फिर आप उसके लिए मिटिगेशन मेजर्स पुट अप कर सकते हो उस रीजन के लिए एंड यू कैन सबमिट टू दैट गवर्नमेंट अथॉरिटीज ऑफ दैट रीजन। अब रिस्पॉन्स की बात करते हैं तो रिस्पॉन्स क्या है। रिस्पॉन्स डीएम एक्ट डिफाइंड रिस्पॉन्स एज द taking of appropriate measure to respond to an event including action taken and the measures planned in the anticipation of during and immediate after an event to ensure that its effect are minimized and that person affected by the event are given immediate relief and support. This is about the response and recovery is an organization method of regaining assess and functionality to its infrastructure after an events. So it may be the event may be a natural or is anthropogenic disaster. Then preparedness refers to measures taken to prepare for and reduce the effects of disaster. तो ये डिजास्टर मैनेजमेंट साइकिल है जो कि मैंने इससे प्रीवियस स्लाइड में जितना भी डिफाइन किया हुआ है पोस्ट डिजास्टर प्री डिजास्टर रिस्पांस प्रिपेयर्डनेस रिहैबिलिटेशन रिकवरी रिस्पांस तो ये सब डिजास्टर मैनेजमेंट साइकिल का पार्ट है। ये एक साइक्लिक प्रोसेस है डिजास्टर मैनेजमेंट। आई एम जस्ट स्किपिंग दिस स्लाइड। मैंने ये आपको कोस्टल हैजार्ड मैप ऑलरेडी ही डिस्कस कर दिया है और ये एक एरिया का इरोजन मैप है कि आप कैसे एनालाइज कर सकते हो इसकी वल्नरेबिलिटी। सो हमारे हाई पावर कमिटी ने मल्टीपल जो हमारी स्टेट्स हैं हमें किस स्टेट को ज्यादा फोकस देना चाहिए विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू डिजास्टर तो दीज रीजन्स आर हिमालयन कोस्टल रीजन रिवराइन एरियाज नॉर्थ ईस्टर्न रीजन आर यूटीज आइलैंड मरीन एसेट्स एंड आर एरिड एंड सेमी एरिड रीजन। अब रिकमेंडेशन फ्रॉम माय स्लाइड्स फ्रॉम माय प्रेजेंटेशन इज वी नीड टू इम्प्रूव द अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ डिजास्टर रिस्क हैजार्ड्स वल्नरेबिलिटी एंड वी नीड टू प्रोवाइड द क्लैरिटी ऑन रोल एंड रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटीज ऑफ वेरियस मिनिस्ट्रीज एंड डिपार्टमेंट इन्वॉल्व इन डिफरेंट हैजार्ड्स। वी नीड टू प्रोवाइड एन इफेक्टिव डिजास्टर मिटिगेशन प्लान hazard assessment and we need to must educate the people about the dangers and how to minimize them if not avoided and obviously there is a need to proceed from hazard assessment to vulnerability analysis for the specific risk map preparation. So thank you very much. Back to you Neetika.
Thank you, Dr. Rajiv, for such a wonderful exposition on the basics of disaster management. Thank you very much, madam. Now coming on to the second session of the day on basics of early warning in communication and SOPs in DM, we have a highly admirable speaker, Dr. Raju Thapa, Junior Consultant, NIDM.
Raju.
Raju has inked his name in more than 40 research publications and book chapters in some of the leading journals. He's an expertise in the field of remote sensing and GIS and its application to water sources, contaminant hydrogeology, groundwater potential mapping, and landslide assessment. I now please request Dr. Raju Thapa to kickstart his presentation. Dr. Raju, over to you.
Hello. Am I audible?
Okay.
Tuchu, I was not able to unmute myself, so sorry for that. Thank you for this opportunity. So let me share my screen first. Please, can you assign me the presenter rights, Nitika ma'am?
Yes, sir. Just give me 1 minute.
Okay. So after that presentation, wonderful presentation. Now I will be talking about early warning and communications. So we will understand why we need to focus on early warning and communication sector. Like my previous speaker, Dr. Harjit Kaur, mentioned that. About the basics of disaster management, but we have to understand that it is very, very important that we should have a knowledge, basic knowledge of at least what are the prevailing disasters in our area, so that we can successfully implement our early warning based on our particular location, so that it is effective. Nitika ma'am, can you confirm if my presentation is
yes, sir. Your presentation is visible to us. Sir.
Thank you very much. So, like I was saying, before I go into the main topic, like always, just to remind you that we are still facing COVID-19. There are cases that are coming up. It is not illuminated completely. So though our efforts, continuous efforts, right from vaccination to everything is playing an important role, but still we need to be cautious. There are some areas where cases are spiking. So we cannot do negligency, and we cannot put our guard down. So we have to be prepared, and we have to keep ourselves very aware and alert. And like Dr. Harjit Kaur said, please follow all the our COVID-19 appropriate behavior, right from physical distancing wherever possible, to using face mask, regular hand washing, covering one's mouth when we are sneezing or coughing outside in the public, for the safety of ourselves and also for the safety of others. Apart from that, we also need to do our regular monitoring of our health, so that if there are any symptoms, signs and symptoms, please go for immediate checkup. And get vaccinated. I think most of us have already got vaccinated. And please encourage your friends also. If you come across some friends who are not taking the doses, you can encourage them, and you can also ask them to take the doses. So, I have shown this this slides several times. But basically, what I want to focus here for today is let me use the highlighter once. So if you just see these two, if you just compare these two 2020 years data from the 1980 to 1999 and from 2000, one thing that that is very interesting, particularly when we are talking about today's my presentation, basics of early warning and communication, is that even though the number of disaster has increased almost double fold, but you will see that the number of people death from disaster is almost same. So there are the one of the most important points that has been attributed to it is that with time there has been advancement in science and technology, and with that we have now institutional setups there out there who are working on that day and night. We are having regular monitoring of various disasters, whether cyclone particularly, where we are doing an excellent job, tsunami, we have inquiries. So every year we have now nodal agencies who are continuously looking after that. And even if there are some small activities, we are, a prior information is sent to the concerned authorities so that appropriate actions is taken based on that. People are moved to the shelters, cyclone shelters, or somewhere relief camp, so that they are safe from the disaster. So such activities has definitely played a role. It has reduced the number of deaths significantly. And just for your information, if you will see, when you consider the total number of people affected by disaster, flood is the number one disaster which affects most of the people. Because when a particular area is flooded, almost entire area, the people out there, they get affected. But when we talk about the number of people death by disaster, earthquake is the one who is taking most of the life of people, because this is where earthquake, sometimes we are still lagging, and sometimes it's very difficult to exactly predict the time when the stress between these tectonic plates will be released. That is something that is very tough to do. And works are going on. We have our NCS who are continuously working on that. But this is, and most of the time this come unpredicted when we are less prepared for that. So that's why number of deaths are high in earthquake, followed by storms, extreme heat and flood. And you take any disaster, you consider any disaster, you will see that there are increase in number in disasters as we are progressing, which also gives us an idea that we need to prepare ourselves, because there is an increase in frequency and intensity of disasters. So we have all our plans, all our future actions, our not only our at personal level, at the government level, at the corporate level, the bureaucrats, they all need to think that whatever policies that we bring, whatever future advancement we do as a country, climate and other things needs to be considered. That was also one of the highlights of COP26 that we have, that got recently, that got over. And our country is blessed with so many rivers, so many mountains, and with blessings also comes some other problems. So you will see that India, when we talk about disaster proneness, India stood third just after China and USA. So our country is prone to a large number of disasters. There are several factors to that. We will discuss in my later slide. And number of affected people also, when you will see, you will understand that particularly because of the high frequency and impact of disaster in Asia, is largely due to the size of the continent also, and landscape that represent a high risk of natural hazard. Like I was saying, like in Asia particularly, you will see in China and here, why? Because there are a number of river basins out there, there are floodplains out there are seismic fault line out there. So all these things makes the area more vulnerable. In addition to that, very important thing is, whenever we talk about the largest population, China and India, they typically dominate the list. So that's why also whenever we talk about the number of people affected by disaster, approximately 70% of the global total is accounted by China and India itself, because of the large population, which itself is a concern. So we have to look on that also. And other aspect, like whenever we talk about disasters, low income people are mostly affected. And when we compare the morbidity to natural disaster, you will find that women and children, particularly those people who are less informations, they are more affected because of that. And particularly women and children, it has been observed that they are more vulnerable to disaster. And according to the UNDP report, United Nations Development Program, you will find that women and children, they are 14 times more likely to die during a natural disaster, which is itself speaks a lot, and which also give us an idea. We have to focus multiple fold towards the safety of women and children. And this has been observed. This is not just an observation. This has been observed in several incidents. The 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami, the cyclone Nargis, the hurricane Katrina, everywhere it was observed. And one more particularly thing that we have as a country, as a whole nation, we have observed is during COVID-19, million of people around the particularly the Asia Pacific regions, they remain exposed to a high frequency and intensity of natural disaster, whether you talk about the locust, swamp and earthquake to cyclone and other exceptional event. And the onset of COVID-19 pandemic has demonstrated how in an increasingly globalized world, such hazards can threaten a systematic global collapse and creating the risk that often interconnect with one triggering another in a cascading of devastating events. And this new disaster health climate nexus must be addressed in order to achieve the sustainable development goal that we always talk about, and which to which India is also a signatory. So what we have understood is that over the past two decades in Asia and in Pacific has made significant progress in achieving the sustainable development goal, but still there is a lot to be done. The world has experienced deep consequences for health and survival, and also national economies and societies have suffered a lot. The pandemic combined with the persistent reality of climate change is therefore reshaping, I will say, and expanding as the riskscape, a disaster riskscape, and particularly in Asia Pacific region. And the region has regressed on the critical goal of climate change. And we have to work together on this emerging disaster climate health nexus, which demands a much more systematic approach to disaster risk reduction. So like I was saying, during the COVID-19 pandemic, the countries, there are several countries that were hit by disaster during that time. Major flood events were reported in China, Japan, Pakistan, and Iran, Kazakhstan, everywhere. You just see this slide, you will understand. This is particularly during COVID-19, where COVID-19 compounded the disaster. The lockdowns, travel restrictions, all were there, okay? And other contaminant measures were there that were imposed as in response to COVID-19. That interrupted established measures for the agencies to take some of the prevention, response, and recovery from natural hazards, because there were restrictions to travel during COVID-19. And at the same time, the natural hazards that also hampered the response to COVID-19 and facilitated its spread, and as people were forced to crowd together in emergency shelters and all. You have seen that in Cyclone Amphan also last year that we have. So in August, just for an example, the city of Karachi in Pakistan were hit by record high flooding. And because of that, several cases has occurred. In Philippines also, Typhoon Goni has made landfall. So which again, and in that typhoon, particularly, I would like to say that because of that Philippines Typhoon Goni, the COVID-19 laboratory was damaged. And because of that, the testing was stopped. And so many COVID testing was stopped because that has delayed the COVID testing, and that has further, in a way, enhance the spread of COVID-19. So you see how one disaster has an effect on others. Let's take the example of India itself. In 2020, the COVID-19 pandemic was rapidly spreading, and in India and also in the Bangladesh, when that cyclone Amphan struck, and it was one of the strongest cyclone that hit densely populated coastal areas, and it has led to extensive flooding. So in West Bengal itself, it damaged I think more than 560 primary health centers, in addition to around 170 block primary health centers were also damaged, and in total around 5,000 community subcenters were damaged. So you can understand the impact that it had, particularly after damaging the health centers, how during COVID-19, the importance of those COVID centers. So that was the effect. Not only that, take the example of the heavy monsoon flood in 2020 that caused in Assam, extensive flood. So there also, which is a very prime example of a convergence of disaster. So in Assam, India, during that time, the highest single day spike of over 1,200 COVID cases occurred during the heaviest flood and multiplied the impact of vulnerable population. This is not only that after flood, the people have to, the COVID was spreading faster. Just see from the angle of the perspective of farmer. Since COVID was there, there was lockdown, there was restriction on travel and all, there was restriction on harvesting the cultivation. On top of that, this flood has occurred. So the farmer whose crops were damaged by the flood were unable to harvest the remaining survivor crops also due to the pandemic lockdown. So it impacted their economy also very badly. So this convergence of biological and natural hazards has added stress to poverty and inequality, further damaging the life prospect of millions of people throughout. And as natural disaster or any other emergency that disperses large number of people is likely to lead to a surge in epidemic diseases. So the overlap between multi-hazard are likely to intensify as a result of climate change. So why we need to talk about multi-hazard is that so that we can have a multi-hazard early warning approach. I think that is the need of the hour. And as a country, we need to work towards that, that we have to have an early warning system, rather multi-hazard early warning system, so that the early warning system can be triggered more frequently, and we have one early warning system that works for several disasters. Coming back to the, now you may ask why we need early warning. This is exactly what I was saying. Particularly, basically, when we say why we need early warning system is for two reasons. One is the safety of human life, because nothing is more important than human life. And the second is the safeguarding the property of a country. So that when we safeguard our property, we save lots and lots of money that can be, if not invested in early warning, that will be invested in rehabilitation and reconstruction and recovery. And if you have proper early warning in place, that money can be saved. So that's why investing in early warning is very, very important. So just to give you a glimpse how early warning system was there earlier, when we talk about our country and disaster management, earlier we didn't have a very prompt and multidimensional proactive holistic approach when we are talking about disaster management. It was later on after the enactment of Disaster Management Act when things were getting streamlined. Earlier, like in this traditional, you will see that we were rather more of relief-based concept. So relief-based concept, what I mean to say here is that once the disaster has occurred, then we will work for the response activity. So whether you talk about the landslide, you talk about cyclone, flood, once the disaster will occur, and after the disaster, we will have the response activity. That was our approach earlier. But now, with the enhanced approach we are following, where at least for the, I will say, the weather-related hazards, we often have some information ahead of the upcoming disaster event. Take the example of cyclone. Before the cyclone, we now have the information from IMD that a depression is forming in Bay of Bengal or in Arabian Sea. So that gives us way ahead information, particularly for weather-related hazards. Or sometimes IMD, they report that we are expecting a heavy rain in this area, so which might result in flood. So all these informations are available beforehand. So we have some information ahead of upcoming disaster event, and that information can be interpreted and used to prepare the emergency operation much, much better. So this is all that we call early warning, early action approach. We make full use of the climate information we have, and we act in a way that prepares us better as a whole, but also with a more strategic approach to disaster response. So like I was saying, our country is prone to a large number of disasters large number of factors that contribute to it, whether they are natural or human induced, including the adverse geoclimatic condition, the topographic features, the environmental degradations. You talk about the population growth, the urbanization, industrializations, all these things are playing a significant role in increase of our proneness to disaster. And the importance of early warning and communication is not that it is not that only India is working on that. The importance of early warning and communication has been recognized throughout the globe, and you will see that it has been focused on, particularly on early warning system, in some of the global platforms also. You talk about the Paris Agreement, where the COP21, there also it has been thought about that we need to work. You talk about this SDGs, particularly goal number 13, where we are expecting actions against climate action. So there also the importance of multi-hazard has been, early warning system has been focused, and particularly in Sendai framework for disaster, the the seventh target, that is the increasing target, oriented target, their multi-hazard early warning system, if you can see here, the multi-hazard early warning system, enhancing the ability of multi-hazard early warning system has been focused. And even Prime Minister 10-point agenda also, where Sri Narendra Modi ji has laid down the 10 mantras, there also, particularly in point number 5 or point number 7, the usage of science and technology in enhancing our disaster risk reduction has been enhanced. So, but the importance of early warning system, we have to understand that. And before going into the main thing, I would just like to give you a basic idea of the component of early warning system, which is not that just the monitoring or the warning that you receive is early warning system. No, that is not the case. It has a whole system. So the four key component of any early warning system are risk knowledge. We should have a risk knowledge. We should have monitoring and warning services. We should have dissemination and communication, and we should also focus on response capacity. Just in short, I will just like to give you a brief idea on each point very shortly. Okay. Risk knowledge, needless to say, after such a wonderful presentation, our first presentation, where we talked about risk knowledge, what is disaster, what are the various aspects, how, where a man discussed so many things. So risk knowledge, now I think you have an idea with the first presentation. So basically here, what we understand is that we understand about the hazards, we understand about the vulnerabilities of a particular location, whichever location, your area of interest, there you carry out the based on the risk assessment and the risk knowledge, where you examine what are the pathways of exposure, what are the level of exposure, what are the sensitivity to hazards, what are the vulnerability that are prevailing there, what are the hazards that might affect. Considering all that, then you come up and with risk knowledge, and based on that you take further actions about monitoring and warning. The next point is monitoring and warning services. Most of the time when we talk about early warning system, this is what comes to our mind, that this is early warning itself, but this is just a component of early warning and communication. So definitely this is one of the most important part in our monitoring in early warning system. So basically here what we do is we collect informations about the sets of proxy variables. What I mean by that is that, let's take an example. Suppose you want to understand flood or drought of a particular area. What are the parameters that we consider? You will consider the rainfall in that area, right? What were the rainfall? So you, that is your variable that you are considering, or that is the rainfall is thing that you will monitor. I'm just giving an example. There are several other factors also. Or suppose you want to understand the earthquake of a particular area, or you want to monitor the earthquake. So you, what you will consider is the seismic wave of that area, you know. So you will record that. So that is your variable. That can be done through direct or indirect observations. Direct observations, like in this case, where you go to the field, directly take the point from the field, that is your direct. Or apart from that, now with the advancement of science and technology, we have remote sensing and GIS, we have satellite communication, we have satellite technology, which makes our job very, very easy. So that can be used, or the land-based radars, suppose the Doppler radars that we have, or the other automatic weather stations that we have, that can be used. An on-ground point, definitely we can use. All these can be used, and all these after using, that needs to be interpreted to see what are the future trend. You know, trend analysis, we have to understand the data. For that, an expertise is needed. And once you have that expertise and you interpreted that data, you can come up with an monitoring and forecasting. So now, once you have monitoring and forecasting, that message, it needs to be disseminated to the various users through different means, such as whether that is a radio, whether that is televisions, social media, print media, mobile application, websites, siren, community radio, all different means can be used for the dissemination and communication. But recently, with the advancement our future advancement technology. Mobile application is playing a very significant role in disseminating of information that we will talk about in separate lectures that is just following after my lectures. So we will understand how mobile technology will is also used. Apart from that, there are different means through which information is provided from, is moved from one level to another level. And the last component that we need to consider is the response capacity. We have to understand one thing very clear that no matter how much we are prepared against disaster, we cannot tame, we cannot, you know, stop disaster from happening. Disaster will occur. So we need to also strengthen our response capacity so that after disaster, we act very promptly and there are as low as, you know, minimum loss of life as much possible. So for that, there are several things that we need to work on. That is preparedness and proper response. It can be additionally enhanced through mock drills and trainings like this one, or by providing checklist of actions to undertake in certain situations, all that thing, and educating community, particularly the endangered community, who may not be that much aware of the, what to do when they receive any warnings. So that thing needs to be carried out. And here just I will like add one more point that, like I was saying in my earlier slide, that women and children, they are left behind in most of the cases. So we have to have an the gender perspective also, age, education, disability, what to do with disabled people. We have to have an approach how we will take care of our people who are disabled, how to carry out response to them. All that needs to be worked and think of. Here, I will just like to say that it cannot be done alone. So it needs coordination and cooperation. This story, I think most of you have already heard of, that where six blind people, they were asked to touch elephant, and whichever part they have touched, some says that the elephant is like in spear, some say it's like in wall. But in one way, all are right. Okay, but that's their personal experience. Whatever they have touched. But if you want to have a holistic approach, we need to combine together so that all their inputs are taken and we have a holistic picture of any disaster. So we need to have various stakeholders on board so that everybody's perspective is considered and nobody is left behind. And during disaster, it is it has been observed, particularly during cyclone or landslides also sometimes, other floods also sometimes. It has been observed that our main mode of communications, it gets disabled, you know, disturbed because of the damage to our infrastructure communications or communication whole infrastructure. So because of that, we need to have a prior arrangement for that. We need to be aware of that. So we need to have an alternative modes of communications, such as take an example of community radio or ham radio in particular, you know, which does not need so much sophisticated powers and it can run on simple batteries also. So such type of, we need to have a backup plan also about communication, because after disaster, communication is very, very important for transmitting the information and also saving the life of the people. Just to give you an example of, let's talk about the flood. So Central Water Commission is the prime is the main organization who is looking after the your flood forecasting in India. So they are looking after all the early warning and prediction. Here, just one important thing that I want to highlight is that this Central Water Commission, they issue 5-day advisory forecast also. And apart from that, they have also signed and collaboration with Google also on 2018 to collaborate on improving the flood prediction systems, which will help the provide the location targeted and actionable flood warning to the people, the flood forecasting initiative that they have named. Basically in here, what happening is that the Google team, they are using their satellite imagery They are using their Google Dam Generation Map, and our Government of India, the Central Water Commission, they are assisting them by providing the data from the monitoring systems, monitoring stations that we have, CWC, the rain gauge and forecasting system. They are combining that and they are preparing an inundation model. That model is, that inundation map is transmitted to various organizations and our CDC also, and that information is transferred to our Government of India also, so that appropriate actions are taken and people are safeguarded from various disasters. So this is just a glimpse of how the model is working. So you can see based on that data, all the modeling has been done, and people are informed that which area will be inundated at it, and also with detail like how much depth will be inundated. All that information, like as you can see, with the increase, like they can also predict at what will the depth of water in your particular location. All that information is available just at your fingertip. If you just go to Google and type, all that information will be available. And that information is also provided to NGOs also, so that they can further disseminate the information to the people. Similarly, for when you talk about tsunami, the Indian, the 2004, everybody remembers the 26th December 2004, the Indian Ocean was struck by a massive earthquake and tsunami that killed more than 2.3 lakh people. So prior to that, tsunami was not considered a high risk hazard, but that has definitely changed our mind now. So when you talk about tsunami, the INQUAIS that was established, or which is an autonomous body, was established in 1999 under the Ministry of Earth Sciences, and is a unit of the Earth System Science organization. We call it ESSO. So they are mandated for the best possible ocean information and advisory services to society, to industry, to government agencies, and the scientific community also. So they have their own system where they are working on. And just for, I won't discuss here in much, for regarding this, we have organized several webinars in NIDM regarding particularly talking about tsunami. I will request you, if you have more interest in this, you can listen here, where we were joined by scientists from INQUAIS itself, who were talking about the how they are working on that. And there are tsunami ready programs also. Overall, I will say that effective end-to-end and people-centered early warning system, they may include four interrelated key elements, that is disaster risk knowledge. Second is the determination, monitoring, analyzing, and forecasting of the hazard. The third is the dissemination and communications by an official source which transmit the authority like timely, accurate, and actionable warning. And the fourth is preparedness at all level to respond to the warning received. And these all four component, interrelated component needs to be coordinated within and across sectors. And a failure in any one of the component or lack of coordination across them could lead to a failure of the whole system. So recommendation is that we need to have a people-centered, enhanced local capacity through various approach, motivate community to initiate buildings and contribute to the aim of SFDRR also. And apart from that, we also need to focus on sharing of knowledge and information in local language, technical innovation, broadcasting techniques and system needs to be further enhanced. So with that, the same things that I was discussing. So since we are running short of time, I would like to end my presentation here. Just like in the end, I will say that disaster risk reduction is key to sustainable development and climate change adaptation. And we have to slowly and gradually move towards that. So thank you very much, Nitika, back to you.
Thank you, Dr. Raju, for such a fruitful session of yours. It was great listening on the topic early warning and communication. Thank you very much, sir. Now moving towards the third and last session of the day, titled Social Media and Mobile Technologies for Disaster Risk Reduction, I would like to welcome Mr. Anil Kathar. Mr. Anil is working as junior consultant with NADM. He has penned 20 research papers on various aspects of landslides hazard mitigation and management, contributed in drafting the engineering guidelines on landslide mitigation measures for Indian roads. With this, may I please request Mr. Anil to kindly start with this session. Mr. Anil, over to you.
Thank you very much, Nitika. I hope my PPT is visible.
Yes, sir, your PPT is visible.
So once again, thanks for giving me this opportunity to discuss social media and mobile technology for disaster risk reduction. The role of new technology to support the efforts to save lives, livelihoods, and to contribute to the rescue, relief, and rehabilitation activities by creating and by nurturing public awareness. So media has an active, valuable, responsible duties in the field of disaster management. Today, news gets circulated promptly in social media, then that traditional one like our print media or this broadcast media. So disaster management is added by the media informing this our community public about disaster by issuing warnings or you can say gathering and transmitting information about affected areas, as well as alerting government officials, relief organizations, the general public to specific needs, and facilitating discussions about disaster preparedness, response for continuous improvement. So I will be discussing in my further slides. Like all you are aware that still COVID is not over, though cases are low, but still we need to follow all the precautionary measures. So I request you to kindly follow, adopt the, all the COVID-19 appropriate behaviors. Coming to the disasters, the definition is has already been discussed by Dr. Kurt. There are many definitions that are used to describe the world disaster by different organizations. But yeah, in simple words, it is an event that's consequences, or you can say destruction, are beyond the coping capacity of affected community. See, there are two terms, one hazard and disaster. Hazard, hazard that is a phenomenon that has potential to cause destruction to life and property. And on the other hand, disaster is a phenomenon that causes a damage to life, property, and environment. So all disasters are hazards, but it is not unnecessary that all hazards will be a disaster. See, there are a number of interventions, national interventions that were carried out for disaster management. Like we have a high power committee that was constituted in 1999. We have DM Act 2005. We have a national policy on disaster management. Our we have national disaster management plan that was formulated in year 2016 and was revised in 2019. And our honorable prime minister during his address at 7th Asian Minister Conference on Disaster Risk, that was in year 2016, outlined 10-point agenda on disaster risk management that was discussed, that discussed all the challenges that are posed by hazards and how to overcome those, and in which he also provided direction to address all the unprecedented challenges of disasters. So point 7 of that agenda, it advocated to utilize the opportunity that is provided by our social media and mobile technology in the field of disaster management. See, when you talk about media, there are major two types of media that exist, one electronic and other print media, like radio and television are a prominent player in electronic media, whereas newspaper, magazines, journals, these are a part of print media. And Technology has a crucial role in information acquisition, in information analysis, forecasting, and dissemination. And with a new technological advances in communication, it offers the prospects of considerable improvement, both in anticipation of sudden onset disaster and in delaying with after effects once disasters occur. So communication underlies virtually all the elements of hazard mitigation process, and the capabilities of communication, data gathering, and data management technologies have leaped forward in parallel with increased knowledge about the origin and behavior of natural hazards and the mitigation of their this effects. see in effective management of disaster, the necessity of the information to right people at right time is crucial, and it has not changed since centuries. So relevant stakeholders or community need warning ahead of any impending disaster or catastrophic event. Also, in its aftermath, regarding information on the casualties, damage, or supplies and skills that are needed, the best way to bring in resources that help, what help is available, and information on the response. information on the rescue relief operation. So right information at right time can save many lives, like in the alert and early warnings that can result in huge number of casualties beside extensive damage to our property. You can take example of Bhopal gas leak of 1984 or super cyclone in Odisha in 1999, or to recent Chamoli tragedy that happened in Uttarakhand in Feb 2021. Where timely alert could have saved many lives and enormous property. So in effective management of disaster, the requirement is right information to right people at right time. So now a question comes, why we need social media. See, as you know, in the disaster vulnerability scenario of India, we need a lot, a tool that can help us to reach the large number of people, to sensitize them, to raise the public awareness about the risk of the disaster in their particular area, and the what are the precautionary measures are to be taken in case of any particular catastrophic events, or helping the response team to identify the people those need any help in disaster situation. So we need a tool or a platform like we have social media, mobile technology for quick dissemination of ground realities and to cut down the response time. In today's this techno-savvy world, social media and this mobile technology has redefined communication, like text messaging, internet, social networking sites have made it possible to communicate with a large number of people anywhere in the earth in within a single click. So it is an efficient and easy way to keep in touch and impart information, particularly in time of the crisis. So why social media over traditional media? In contrast of this traditional forms of media, which are often limited in reach and constant to the location where they are performed, social media technologies are able to overcome this limitation in a broad sense. And the advantage of social media can over traditional media can be understood with the help of the 5 C's. And these 5 C's are collectivity, connectivity, completeness, and clarity, and collaboration. So, coming to the collectivity nature of social media serve to connect people across geographical boundaries and the time zones via common platforms to foster the growth of online communities with similar interests. When you talk about connectivity, unlike other forms of media or communication, social media is capable of connect users to the resource through the sharing of web links. Completeness, social media is able to capture a contribution and keep them in a persistent state for others to view, share. Coming to the clarity, content on this social media website is usually highly visible, and with participating people aware of each other's activities and content that are posted. And last, collaboration, people are encouraged to share, they are encouraged to contribute in the areas they are interested in by gathering information and providing this feedbacks and all. Coming to the characteristic of the social media that it encompasses a wide variety of content format. It includes text, it includes video, photographs, audio, PowerPoint and all. And many social media make use of this option by allowing more than one content alternative. So basically it allows interaction to cross one or more platforms through social sharing, emails, and feeds, and it involves a participatory approach where different participants can create or they can comment on the social media networks, and information can be quickly disseminated. And you know, in social media, communication can be between one to one or one to many, or it can also be between many to many. So communication can be done in real time through social media, and it can take place via your laptop, your computers, or your mobile phones. So real-time online events can be created that can be used later for offline interactions. So why the social media is important for disaster management? What is the role of its role in disaster management, role of social media in disaster management? Like I mentioned, the platform helps in quick dissemination of information, the quick dissemination of ground realities to a wider population. So this social media tools aid in locating the affected people in any disasters and also enable two-way interaction between victims and the rescuing team. And it make relief operation more effective and timely by facilitating various organizations, various NGOs in raising relief material and money, as well as relevant or concerned disaster management authorities can also get information regarding any disaster situation that have occurred in their respective geographical area, and therefore can aid in taking appropriate measures to reduce the impact of the event. So social media can also be used for data collections, for updating alerts, and as well as for notification. It can be helpful in all phases of disaster management. It can aid in preparing the communities for any unpleasant event by providing a better understanding of the risks that are associated with an event, or as well as the precautionary, the safety measures the community can use to combat that event. And it can also aid in quick response and rescue measures, so that helping the disaster managers cut down the response time. See, the growth of mobile coverage and this rise of mobile-enabled technology have created a new opportunity for emerging economies to help disaster management. Like mobile phone technology have potential to enable quick and immediate access to data, which can help in early response. Apps or this online forms can also act as a filter for data quality checks and assuring data consistency without the need for any specialized knowledge and decreasing data entry errors. So on this technology, mobile phone technology can allow information such as this technology can be used for early warning messages to be shared instantly and directly with people in danger in remote locations, and reducing the time it takes for this critical information to reach them, and thus giving more time to act, more time to prepare in advance of a disaster, and potentially reducing the disaster's impact. And certain apps have been developed, like you can see, for imparting the awareness in the field of disaster management. This apps are available on your Google Play Store and other platform for, and that can be utilized for enhancing the awareness about disasters and their management. Basically, these apps provide basic information regarding various hazards, and few apps are also designed for children, and they can also learn from these apps how to deal with any emergency situation and what are the tools or what are the don'ts for different hazards. There are many merits as well as many demerits of the social media. Misuse of this platform of social media is a big concern. It is more than just a tool to disseminate information. So it's also a way to join in on conversation, developing partnership. But when rumors is created in such platform like social media, people are misled, and in the process, there is loss of confidential information, and people may fail to notify about the revised safety measures or the latest information on any crisis situation, and it can result in chaos and confusion. For example, when the whole world was struggling to combat COVID-19, social media was flooded with various rumors approvals of COVID-19, about there's various guidelines that were issued by our government. So miscommunication have been trending on social media and have been circulating during the COVID-19. There were many rumors that were circulated, like deduction in salary or Disaster Management Act prohibits any citizen apart from government to post any updates or anything regarding COVID-19. Some also share that some this drinking hot water with lemon slice and baking soda it is a cure for COVID-19. So even self-test techniques were also shared in social media platform. So such rumors, such fake news created chaos. So every individual should realize that managing this any crisis or emergency situation not only restricted to any particular section like disaster management authority, but we all have to contribute in it. Circulation of such fake news will only hamper the management of effective management of any crisis situation. So now question comes, is there any legal recourse for stopping spread of such rumors for hampering the course of managing a crisis, or do we have something in the bucket of law for amplifying the crisis situation due to spread of fake news? So certainly there are some provision like in the Disaster Management Act 2005, there is chapter 10, offense and penalties that have certain provision to punish the culprits. And there are total 10 sections in that chapter highlighting the necessary action to be taken against different types of offense. Like you can get punishment for false warning, whoever makes or circulate a false alarm or warning. As for disaster or its severity or about the magnitude of that particular event, which lead to panic environment in the communities, that person can be punishable with imprisonment, which may extend it to 1 year, or the person can also be fined, or both. Similarly, there is section 69A in the Information Technology Act 2000 that also empowers central government to issue certain directions for blocking for public access of the this any information through any computer resources, and the and it, central government has power to issue directions to block, remove objectionable content on the social media and any other website. And the person or the concerned authority who failed to compile with the direction issued might be punished with imprisonment or for terms of up to 7 years, and he or she shall also be liable for fine. Then there is then IPC section 505(1)(b). We say ki a person can also be booked if his any statement conducive to public trouble with intent to cause fear or alarm to the public, or induced to commit an offense against the state or against the public awareness. So this IPC section 505 was implemented in states like Kerala, Hyderabad, and Tamil Nadu, also I think in Maharashtra, on false claims that are related to COVID-19 in year 2020. So apart from the legal options, what we can do to tackle the fake news, how to check the authenticity of the information, what should be our role? At most of the time, we forward the message we received in our social media without thinking about its authenticity, whether we are getting the message in our WhatsApp or in our Facebook, Twitter. We forward it without knowing its own authenticity. So during initial phase of lockdown, why there was chaos amongst this migrant workers? Because the information they received, they didn't check its accuracy. They didn't cross-check it with the information or the guidelines that were released by government. Whatever the information they received from some particular section, they believed that, and that all the chaos was created. So the very first step is to cross-check the information we receive via any social media platform or by any some concerned person. We need to check that information with a government website, like our government website is there, a public information bureau. And if you see a shocking or particular engaging photo or any video in an article, take a moment to determine whether the media pertains to the main gist of the story or is intended solely to incite an emotional reaction in the readers. You can use a service of Google image search to conduct a reverse image search, and this search will show where else on the web the image appears, and it will also indicate whether the image has been tampered with or not. And for many video clips that go viral. There is additional video footage that either isn't shown or hasn't yet been published, and that tell a different story, and as well as these photos that support a certain instance or viewpoint are sometimes staged, they are sometimes digitally edited to misrepresent the true content. And in both instances, it can be difficult to tell what is real and what is unreal. So we need to evaluate the trustworthiness of the media resource of the image, the person who shared the media or the outlet where it was originally published. So a little time you spend on researching might show whether they any of these sources has a particular agenda, or whether the person who captured or the person who is sharing that message could be spreading any misinformation. He or she can be spreading that by intentionally, or it can also be go through unintentionally. And the most important is that every individual irrespective of its sector is accountable for the safety of nation, and it is our moral duties, ethics to work towards making their disaster resilience. And managing disaster is not only restricted to disaster management authorities, but every individual has to play its part in managing the crisis situation. So our activities should be in harmony of the growth and sustainable development of our nation. So what way forward that can be taken from this talk? So like I mentioned, social media can play important role in pre-disaster. It has important role during disasters as well as post-disaster phases. Social media can enhance preparedness. It can enhance preparedness by raising public awareness about risk of the disasters. It can provide informations and instructions with real-time alerts and real-time warnings. It can facilitate in monitoring early warning of the disaster. This new technology can locate people during disaster who needs any help. It can also identify volunteers for responding during any emergency situation. So this tool, the tool of social media, it can help in operation of rescue. It can help in operation of relief as well as rehabilitation. Today, this social media has become a valuable means of communication in many places that are affected by a natural disaster, which allows people to keep in touch with family, friends, and also to access the important information. But the thing is that social media cannot and should not be succeed whatever the current approach to disaster management communication or replace existing infrastructure. But when and if this social media platform managed strategically, it can be used to boost our current communication system. So I will conclude my this talk here with a request that the most important role we can play is helping to stop the spreading of fake news, spreading of misinformation and rumors regarding any crisis situation. So only read credible sources, like you can follow PIB news or news that are released by government. And whenever you come across any fake news, inform others through social media that don't believe this news. Yeah, it's a fake one. So with this, thank you very much, and I'm back to you, Nitika.
Thank you, Mr. Anil Kathad, for such a wonderful session on social media disaster management of yours, sir. Thank you very much. And with this, I would like to inform the participants that your questions can be taken tomorrow, as we're running short of time. So I would like to inform you all that you may put up your questions in the chat box. And also, all the three faculty members will be available with us tomorrow. And you can raise your hands and directly talk to them and quote your questions. So with this, I conclude our today's session. Now, I would like to place a special thanks to Dr. Raju Thapa, Dr. Harjeet Kaur, and Mr. Anil Kathad for the wonderful and fruitful sessions of theirs. And I would also like to thank all the participants for their active participation, and would request you all to be with us for the next 2 days also. Tomorrow, the session will begin at sharp 11 a.m. So I would request you all to kindly join the session before time. Thank you all, and see you all tomorrow. Have a nice day. Jai Hind.